Welcome to the UniSA 3-Minute Thesis Grand Final. My name is Rebecca Morse from Adelaide's 10 Eyewitness News. I'm a proud graduate of UniSA's journalism degree, so it's my pleasure to act as your MC this morning. I haven't completed a PhD though, so I'm feeling a little underqualified to be in this company this morning. We acknowledge this land that we gather on today is the traditional lands for the Kaurna people and that we respect their spiritual relationship with their country. We also acknowledge the Kaurna people as the custodians of the Adelaide region and that their cultural heritage and beliefs are still as important to the living Kaurna people today. We've got 7 finalists today and they've all competed in the heats to make the UniSA Grand Final today. There's a lot at stake. Our winner earns themselves $3,000 plus a trip to the Trans-Tasman competition in Perth in November. Our second place getter wins $1,000 and our third place getter takes away $500. Plus we have a People's Choice Award, which also wins $1,000. So pretty rich awards here at stake. So our judges will be assessing today's competitors on comprehension and content, as well as engagement and communication. So competitors should clearly explain the background and significance of their research, clearly explain their key results and findings, use non-specialist language, especially avoid jargon. Remember, I'm just a newsreader, and I'm blonde, so keep it simple. Be well-paced, well-timed, well-structured, show their enthusiasm, get attention, get the audience wanting to know more. Presentations must be a maximum of 3 minutes and going over will result in instant disqualification. Competitors may use only one static visual slide, so there's no additional props or media allowed. I'm a bit disappointed by this. Must be spoken, no poems, raps or songs. Yeah, that kind of sounds fun. So timing will start on the first word. They'll be given a warning cue at 2.5 minutes. So let's get started. Please join me in welcoming our first finalist. Natalie Stevens from the School of Pharmacy and Medical Sciences. Her presentation is titled HMGB1, The Key to Stopping Sepsis in Its Tracks. Welcome, Natalie.
When you think of your immune system, you might think of it, like I first did, as a shield that's always there protecting you from germs like bacteria and viruses. But in my study, I learnt the immune system is actually a powerful weapon, seeking out germs that get into our bodies and killing them without us even knowing. And it does this by first triggering a biochemical process called inflammation, which is the first line immune defence against germs that causes redness, soreness and swelling. But like any weapon, the immune system can have dangerous consequences, even to the host. An example of this is sepsis, which you might know of as blood poisoning or septicemia, and it happens when an ordinary infection, like pneumonia, isn't contained properly and instead spreads to the blood, where it's able to cause inflammation throughout the whole body. And once started, this whole body inflammation doesn't stop. Like a runaway train, it becomes so strong that it's self-perpetuating, driven by the very damage that it's causing. About 15,000 Australians a year will get sepsis, and about a third of these people will die. Those who survive might have serious brain, kidney, or heart damage, and this can affect the rest of their lives. So how can we stop runaway inflammation in sepsis? Well, HMGB1, which is a protein that I've shown there in the purple, is released when cells die, and it acts like an alarm to the immune system to trigger inflammation by binding to cells and causing them to release inflammation signals. So my first aim was to show that HMGB1 was involved in the lethal inflammation in sepsis. So I sampled patients with septic shock from an intensive care unit, and I found those that died from their sepsis had a higher level of this HMGB1 alarm protein. So my next step was to look at blocking this protein, and how could I block it? Using antibodies, which I've shown below in the yellow as Y-shaped proteins. They're blood proteins that stick specifically to a foreign particle, normally in our body that attack foreign germs, but I can use them to block HMGB1. In my work, I use sheep antibodies, which are fast to use and cost-effective to make, and already used for some human therapies, like antivenoms. My method of making sheep antibodies is 10 times faster than standard methods, and I want to use antibodies made this way to treat sepsis. So after making my antibodies in the laboratory, I tested them against HMGB1 protein on cells in a dish, and I found that they were able to stop it from causing inflammation. So next I used my antibodies in 2 mouse models of sepsis, and I found in both of my models that the use of the antibodies reduced disease symptoms, weight loss, and inflammation signals in the mice. They didn't become as sick as mice that didn't get my antibodies. So my next step would be to use it in a large animal model of sepsis to see how they work with antibiotics and the sort of clinical care a patient might receive in the clinic. And my hope is that this work will result in the development of a new therapy that doctors can use to stop the runaway train of sepsis in its tracks. Thank you.
Okay, our second finalist is Shahriyar Khan from the School of Management, and his presentation title is Company Survival.
A quarter of a million Australians have lost their jobs ever since the global financial crisis of 2008. That figure goes to approximately 5 million jobs when we talk about the United States of America. Now, imagine a world where we could change that. Such a world does exist for companies which have followed a blueprint which has got them success day in, day out, come hail, come snow, come sunshine. My study explores the factors that allows a company to economically sustain itself and survive in any economic climate. These factors are resources, culture, innovative capability, systems, and strategy. The global financial crisis and market crash of 2008 saw a lot of large companies like Lehman Brothers go bankrupt. When large companies die, people ask lots of questions. And ever since, CEOs have wanted to know how to make their enterprises survive for an extended period of time in this tough economic climate. Now, how did I do my research? It's quite simple. I went ahead and chose a lot of large companies. And I studied them on a longitudinal basis over a period of 28 years. The method that I used was that I analyzed the content of their annual reports. All these companies came from the Dow Jones Industrial Average Index. This is the oldest and most robust index in the financial world. To be in this index, your company needs to be the best. It needs to have the highest sales. It needs to have the highest profits. There are companies which have been in this index since the early 1900s, and they are still there to this particular date. I'm talking, and they are classic examples of long-lived companies. I'm talking about companies like General Electric and Procter & Gamble. On the other hand, we've had companies which have been in this index for a very long period of time, but they eventually fall out because they couldn't survive the latest crisis. I'm talking about, a good example is Kodak. After individually examining 280 annual reports, the following results have been concluded. The long-lived companies have prioritized the identified factors over the entire 28 years. On the other hand, the companies which fell out of the Dow Jones, they have shown that they did prioritize strategy and systems, but they have neglected to prioritize the other factors, and this has led to their fall from grace. My study concludes that companies that are willing to prioritize the factors of organizational sustainability can survive and thrive in any economic environment. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Our third finalist is Emily Johnston from the School of Pharmacy and Medical Sciences. Her presentation title is Mosquito Research, Saving Lives with Pantyhose and Paperclips.
I came to Australia to study the deadliest animal in the world. Now, there may be some Australian audience members thinking, Struth, science has finally recognized the importance of the drop bears. But I'm not studying drop bears, because around the world, by transmitting diseases like malaria and dengue fever, mosquitoes kill more than 1 million people every year, making them the deadliest animal on the planet. Now, in Australia, the most common mosquito-borne disease is Ross River virus, and it occurs at high rates in some areas, but not others. My question is why? What is it about certain areas that makes them breed disease? If we can understand the environmental factors that contribute to disease transmission, then we can alter the environment or target our control efforts to prevent human infections. But to answer that question, I had to find out where the infected mosquitoes were in South Australia. And traditionally, testing mosquitoes for virus has always been difficult. So I used a new technique. It takes these cards, which are embedded with virus-preserving chemicals, and coats them in honey. Mosquitoes will come to feed on the honey, and in the process, spit virus onto the card, where it can later be detected. Now, no one had ever used this technique in a broad-scale virus survey before, so I had to adapt it. I developed new traps and set them at over 100 field sites across South Australia. Then I captured over 20,000 hungry mosquitoes and let them feed on the card for a week before testing the cards for virus. Now, you may not think that these traps look very impressive, but science doesn't have to be beautiful. It has to be effective. And these traps are proving to be our most sensitive method of detecting infected mosquitoes. I found three types of infection: Ross River virus, Barmah Forest virus, and Stratford virus, which has never before been found in South Australia. I now have the virus data I need to conduct my analysis, and I'm collecting publicly available data about the environment surrounding my traps, like the density of human housing, the biodiversity of mammals, and the ratio of green space to buildings, to see if any of those environmental factors can link these virus hotspots that I've shown here. But the most exciting part of my research so far has been the success of this method. Public health officials in Victoria, Queensland, and Western Australia have been in contact with us about implementing this technique for their surveillance next year. And I developed these traps on a tight budget. I used recycled milk cartons, pantyhose, and paper clips to make the traps. Each trap costs less than a dollar and can be reused for the whole season. That was important to me because the majority of mosquito-borne disease risk happens in economically impoverished countries. In India, for example, where about a quarter of the population lives on a dollar a day, there are 33 million cases of dengue infection every year. With my low-budget virus surveillance and spatial analysis method, I can help any country, regardless of resources, find out where their deadliest animals occur, why they're there, and how we can stop them from infecting humans. Thanks.
Our fourth finalist is Cassie Hilditch from the Centre for Sleep Research in the School of Psychology, Social Work and Social Policy. Her presentation is entitled Waking Up Tired: Effects of a Nighttime Nap on Performance and Alertness. Thank you, Cassie.
I want you all to think about how you felt when you first woke up this morning. Did you wake up feeling tired, a little groggy or disoriented, like you needed a strong coffee, a hot shower, and about 30 minutes to start thinking straight? Well, this is what we call sleep inertia. It's when the momentum of sleep continues into wakefulness. And it's during this period that our ability to process information is impaired. So for most of us, this occurs while we're shuffling around the house getting ready for work or school. So what's the problem? Well, consider shift workers. People who work on call, people who nap on shift, people like emergency service workers, pilots, and doctors. These people may have to make life-changing decisions, problem-solve time-critical situations, or simply drive a vehicle soon after waking. And it's in these scenarios that sleep inertia can be a significant safety risk. Now, the current guidelines for napping on shift say that you can sleep for up to half an hour. This way, you won't go into a deep sleep and you'll avoid sleep inertia. But this advice is based on studies conducted in the afternoon, and we don't really know what might happen after a half an hour nap at night, say at 4 a.m. when we're most sleepy. So what did we do? Well, we took 21 healthy adult subjects and confined them to the sleep laboratory for one night and deprived them of sleep to simulate a night shift. We gave one group a 30-minute nap ending at 4 a.m. and the other group were kept awake for the whole night. We then tested the performance of both groups at 4 a.m. and again every 15 minutes for the next hour. And what did we find? Well, our research showed that performance after the nap was significantly worse than before the nap, and worse than the control group who had had no nap at all. And this performance impairment continued for up to half an hour after the nap. And interestingly, when we asked people to rate how they felt they had performed, they said they performed better after the nap. That is, they were completely unaware of the impact that sleep inertia had had on their performance. So what's the message? Well, this research is informing and challenging current fatigue risk management guidelines for napping on shift. We now know that if you take a 30-minute nap ending at 4 a.m., then you should include an additional 30-minute buffer zone before returning to safety critical duties. We also need to educate workers about the risks of overestimating their performance during this period. Our future research will look at shorter naps to see whether they can provide immediate performance benefits without the side effects of waking up tired. Thank you.
Time for our fifth finalist now, Yinyu Chu from the Institute for Telecommunications Research. Her presentation is called Energy Efficient Wireless Communication for Implanted Medical Devices. Thank you.
In 1958, the first clinical implantation into a human of a fully implantable pacemaker was carried out in Sweden. The device only lasted for 3 hours, and the patient, who died 43 years later at the age of 86, received 26 different pacemakers during his lifetime. Nowadays, the heart pacemaker is one of the many implants that can be placed inside the human body for various monitoring, diagnostic, and therapeutic purposes. As technology has advanced, wireless communication capabilities have been integrated into these devices. This has enabled a new type of network called the Wireless Body Area Network that connects multiple in-body and on-body sensors to achieve functions such as remote and continuous monitoring of patient vital signs. One of the most critical requirements for implant communication is to have a low power consumption. This is because we want the device to be small as possible, as safe as possible, and its lifetime to be as long as possible. In a typical wireless sensor, the majority of the power is consumed by dialogue communication. Therefore, my research only focuses on the communication part of the implant and aims to use wireless communication theory to discover how to transfer information between an implant and an external device by using as little energy as possible. Our body is not an ideal medium for wireless communication. Different body tissues have different physical properties. This constitutes a very complicated environment for signal propagation. This environment also changes with different implant positions, body shapes, and postures. As a result, when a signal travels between the implant and external device, the received signal strength is not always the same, even if the transmission distance is fixed. Some existing wireless implants use a single type of waveform for transmission all the time. However, my analysis and simulation results suggest that this strategy cannot achieve the best energy efficiency. To overcome this, I have proposed a new adaptive system where the implant itself is able to measure the communication environment and then choose a transmission waveform accordingly in order to optimize the overall energy consumption. By using this adaptive method, I have shown that up to 40% of the energy used in data communication can be saved. Up to now, my study has focused on an interference-free scenario where the communication happens between only one implant and one external device. In the rest of my PhD, I will study the energy consumption issues in a multi-user scenario in a typical hospital or healthcare environment. Thank you.
Our sixth finalist is Mohsen Varsi from the School of Management. His presentation title is Incorporating Economic, Environmental and Social Indicators in Supply Chain Design. Thank you, Mohsen.
I've been advised to start my presentation by asking you to imagine. So please imagine that this building has just collapsed. Sorry for this little bit painful imagination for all of us and costly for UniSA, but this happened last year in one of Asian countries. A factory collapsed and around 1,200 workers died. 1,200 people, men and women. The factory was a supplier of clothing products for famous companies that you and I often wear their brands. That's why they've gathered recently to think how they can avoid these disasters resulting from overlooking the social aspect of supply chains, such as supplier working condition. In business, these disasters put companies' financial performance and reputation at huge risk because of customer backlash. To address this problem and some other issues such as climate change, one effective approach might be to incorporate multiple indicators or performance measures in supply chain design. This is exactly the focus of my research. First of all, what is supply chain? To explain in simple terms, supply chain is a name referred to a group of companies working together to provide products for customers. And supply chain design normally employs advanced mathematical models in order to find the most ideal structure of this group of companies, which might expand internationally. For example, see Apple mobile phones, developed in the United States, manufactured in China, and distributed and sold all around the world. So far, many companies have designed their supply chains only based on economic performance indicators, and you can see a consequence of this approach here. However, my research aims to extend this by simultaneously adding some environmental indicators such as greenhouse gases or carbon emission, and some social indicators such as the impact of business on community. I devised a new mathematical model that enables managers to integrate multiple performance measures, analyze various impacts of decisions before action, and ideally optimize and balance decisions. I have tested the application of my research in an industrial sector in Australia. The findings give some new insight into the way some large-sized companies in the industry currently design and manage their supply chains, and suggest a new structure in which economic, environmental, and social indicators are considered, and if applied, will result in improved overall performance in the long term. I hope my research one day will assist in solving global issues facing the world, facing our shared future, and facing quality of life for all of us, including. Thank you.
Our seventh and final finalist this morning is Alex Cavallaro from the School of Engineering. His presentation title is Hospital-Acquired Infections, the Flesh-Eating Bugs in the Healthcare System. Thank you, Alex.
The premise is simple. You are injured, sick, go to hospital, get treatment, and you get better, right? But in many cases, you don't. The treatment actually makes you worse. You and 200,000 other Australian hospital patients literally catch a bug whilst in hospital. And in many cases, it can't be treated. You now have an antibiotic resistant bacterial infection. But where did it come from? Well, antibiotic resistant bacteria are really common. About 30% of the people in this room will have some sort of antibiotic resistant bacterial infection growing on them right now. And they can actually be transferred from one person to another, or from a person to a surface, and vice versa. But we're not all sick. We don't all have deadly urinary tract infections, or these big pus-filled wounds where the flesh is slowly being eaten away and you get little droopy bits. It's when they enter the bloodstream that they actually become a big problem. And this happens all the time in Australian hospitals. An infected medical device, say, a catheter, an IV drip line, or in the case behind me, an infected knee implant, literally carries the infectious bacteria into the body. Now, when this happens, you'll get fever, chills, eventually the bacteria will release toxins, and you're likely to die within 30 days of the infection. And if you're unfortunate enough that it is an antibiotic-resistant bacteria, there's no treatment. But what if we took a step back? What if we could prevent the bacteria from entering the body in the first place? That's actually where my PhD research comes in. Using advanced nanotechnology and a strong chemical binding process, I'm able to change the surface properties of any medical device and make it inherently antimicrobial. Basically, as bacteria come in contact with the surface my modified medical devices, the surface kills the bacteria. Then, when you bring the surface the medical device in contact with the patient, there's no bacteria to get them infected in the first place. In general, my PhD research is about taking existing and even new medical devices and turning them inherently antimicrobial, making them self-cleaning medical devices. And basically, my aim is to try and generate a novel method of preventing infections before they even happen. And hopefully one day I can use this and try and eliminate some of those flesh-eating bugs in the healthcare system. Cheers.
Thank you, Alex. And thank you for putting that picture up on the screen just before we're due to break for lunch. We did have an eighth finalist, Louisa Mattison from the School of Education. She unfortunately was a late scratching today, but we did want to acknowledge her as a finalist and acknowledge her work. So thank you, Louisa. Okay, thank you to all of our finalists. Absolutely mind-boggling. I didn't know that you weren't even going to work from notes. So I am, as I said, someone who's relying on an auto cue every night is absolutely blown away by your public speaking skills. So let's give all our finalists a big round of applause. Yeah, all of you, just amazing. I don't envy our judges who will now head upstairs to decide the winner. So you two now can have your say in the People's Choice ballot, which you would have found on your chair. You just have to pick one, unfortunately. We will take a short refreshment break now while your votes are counted, and we'll return in about 25 minutes to announce all our winners. Thank you for your attention. I'm going to start today with our People's Choice winners. So your favourite from the floor, and they take home a nice prize of $1,000. And your favourite was Emily Johnston. So Emily, of course, told us about her mosquito research, saving lives with pantyhose and paper clips. Even the title itself is very engaging. Well done, Emily. In third place today, I'm nervous for you all, taking home $500 is Natalie Stevens. Natalie's presentation was HMGB1, which in itself is a mouthful, so well done having to say that several times, the key to stopping sepsis in its tracks. Second place, with a $1,000 check, is Cassie Hilditch. Yes, no, we definitely didn't fall asleep. You kept us wide awake during that presentation. And having a child that woke me up at 5 a.m. this morning, we need to talk, Cassie. Okay, drum roll. The winner of our first place, who wins $3,000 but will also travel to the Trans-Tasman final in Perth, which is at the University of Western Australia on the 3rd of November. And that is Emily Johnston again. Very popular. I feel like Emily should say a few words.
I think I've already said enough words, haven't I? thank you guys so much. Again, thank you to all the judges and to Rebecca. Just to make you guys feel better, none of the competitors have PhDs yet either, so you're in good company. This is not an easy competition. Obviously, really excellent competitors. I think the quality of the presentations goes up year after year. It takes a lot of effort to make a 3-minute talk. And it feels really short when you're preparing it and incredibly long when you're standing up here. So well done to all of you guys. And I think it's such a great competition. It's good for us because it really makes us distill our work into its important pieces and think about why we're actually doing this. And it's great also just to get to hear all the diversity of research that's going on at this university. There's quite a lot of different things that are being researched, and it's really great to see. So thank you guys all for coming, and thank you again. I'm honored.